Well, moms, today is your day. It's a day to say thank you for loving us, caring for us, and guiding us. It's a day to recognize all you do and all you are to us, your perfect, wonderful, amazing children. Thanks for all the early mornings and for taking care of the things we take for granted. Thanks for never giving up on us, even when we stress you out. Thanks for making sure we have what we need and for giving us your heart even when you're sick and tired. Thanks for working hard even when we're a handful and for loving us unconditionally when our attitude is anything but lovable. You're our everything, Mom, and we'd be a mess without you. Today, we thank God for the wonderful gift of you. Happy Mother's Day.
Well, good morning, Countryside family, friends, and guests. We're so glad that you've joined us on our live stream portal. I want to say happy Mother's Day to all you moms out there that are watching. You make us better sons. You make us better daughters. I'm not a daughter, but you get what I mean. You just make us better. So thank you. We honor you today. And hey, as we get going here, 1 Corinthians 14, Paul admonishes the church in Corinth, and he says, God is here truly among you. What a declaration over the church, that God is here. And if you can remember back in those days, there wasn't an active church building. The Corinth church, they were meeting in homes. They were praying for one another there and encouraging one another, and God saw that as his people. And so the church is not a building, it's a people. And I want to say that over you, family, that God is here and he's truly among you. If the Spirit's in you, because of your faith and trust and belief of Jesus Christ, who rose from the dead to take your sin, and if you believe that, God is truly here among you. So hey, as we get going here in musical worship, would we respond with thankfulness and praise?
Yeah. Of the world, his blood breaks the chains. Yeah. Good morning. Welcome to Countryside Christian Church. We are so glad to know that you are here with us on the other side of that screen, that we can be together to worship in spirit and in truth, because who can stop the Lord Almighty? None of this stuff can. So we're so glad to have you here with us today. You know, we're working behind the scenes to bring an impact to our community in Jesus' name. This week, it was Teacher Appreciation Week for all of the public and private school teachers in our country, in our nation, and we were able to go with our partnership with Kennedy Elementary School and deliver a note and a gift card for every teacher at that school. And church, it's just, we are unleashing compassion in the name of Jesus, and we want to thank you for your generosity and your participation in helping us do that in our community. And so many of you have switched your giving to online giving through our PushPay app. You can find that on our website under the Giving tab. It's really making a difference for us, and we just want to say we appreciate you and we thank you for that and for your faithful giving of tithes and offerings. You know, we really need to stay connected to you now more than ever, church. So we ask you and invite you to fill out the online connection card that you will find on our website. Our worship host will be putting that in the chat feed, so you can click that and go to a new window. You won't lose your place here in our service, but you can fill that out now, or you can go after the service is over and complete that. We'd love to know, to share with us as much information as you are comfortable giving, and we really would love to know who is watching with you. Pastor John is continuing his sermon series on impact today, and he's prepared sermon notes that you can download and view from our website under ministry resources, and those are there early in the weekend so that you have time to print them off and be ready for church. I'm really excited to share about an opportunity that's coming up very soon for us here at Countryside, and that is Financial Peace University. So we find that planning for the future is hard when you're still paying for the past, right? So there is a better way. So we invite you to join our Financial Peace University class, where we're going to learn how to beat debt and make a plan for the future together. So of course, you got to know this is going to take place online, and we invite you to do that. It's going to start on Sunday, May 24th, and the group's going to meet at 7 p.m. And you need to register online for this at the website listed And to reference that, you can also find it on our Facebook page as well. We have a unique link so that you can be a part of our group and not just another financial peace group somewhere around the nation. We want you to be there with us. And once you've registered, you'll be getting email information from our class coordinator, and you'll get the Zoom link for how you can join our classes then. Before I leave, I just want to wish all the moms out there a happy Mother's Day. And we've put together a special video with some of the moms from our very own Countryside family. I want you to just allow their words to encourage and bless you today as we celebrate the hard work that our moms put in for us. We love you. So we'll see you and watch this video.
Hi, my name's Alicia. I'm a mom of two.
My name's Samantha, and I am the mother of one child.
My name is Amy, and I am a stepmom to one 12-year-old and four kids ages 3 and under.
I'm Leah Thompson, and I have two children. They're grown. One is married. I have one grandchild, and he is such a delight.
I'm Elizabeth. I'm a mother of two outside the womb and one inside the womb.
Hi.
Hi.
I'm Gina. My husband and I raised four kids.
Okay.
And we have nine grandkids.
So I became a mother a little later. So I'd had experience seeing kids and helping raise kids, and my siblings mm-hmm. were younger than me. But I think one of the things I wish someone would have told me was there's no perfect people, but there are perfect moments. And yeah, just to find that you're going to mess up. Like it's going to happen and it's okay. There's like no way no matter your intentions, but there are so many moments that go so fast, and just to learn to recognize those and to live in those moments. I think that's just the best thing. And sometimes they're messy moments, but they're still really perfect, and you can just find joy.
What's your favorite part about being a grandma?
My favorite part about being a grandma? You know, I think it is just the wonderment of all of it. Mm-hmm. He is just in awe of everything, wants to touch everything. His curiosity is great. His imagination is just really fun. And it's just fun to watch him explore everything. He's just a year old, so it's just everything is brand new, of course, for him. And it's just so fun to watch him explore things and learn things and to light up. When I walk in the room, he gets all excited, and it's just really fun. He reaches out for me, and, you know, it just warms your heart.
What is the funniest thing one of your toddlers has said this week?
I asked him what his favorite animal was, and he looks at me and he says, pasta.
Oh, yeah.
And I was like, okay, but pasta's not an animal, so what's your favorite animal? And he just looked at me, he said, I like pasta.
Something that you wish someone had told you as you began motherhood?
Yeah, I wish they would have told me to just relax. It's really easy to get caught up in the, I don't know what to do, and I'm not good at this. Mm-hmm. But in the end, when they become awesome adults and parents of they become parents. All of those worries that you had as a young mom are not that important. It's the milestones and the love you have in your family and the way you interact together. Those are the things that really bind everything together.
So how many diapers do you think you've changed in the last week? I'd say probably about 70. Talk to me about how you teach your child about Jesus.
Yeah, so I really try. I have an elementary age child, and I really try to bring Jesus into the everyday. Mm. So we're having a rough morning. We're grumpy in the car on the way to school. So, you know, hey, how about we just say a prayer right now and talk to Jesus, and he can help us, you mm-hmm. know, have a better day. Let's just do that. You know, we're driving in a car. It's fine. Helping her see how that relationship can happen.
I think it would have been nice if somebody had told me that if the grass seems greener on the other side of the fence, it's probably because that grass is fake. Yeah. It's really easy at least for me, to post like your highlight reel on social media. And so then you go on someone else's page and you forget that. And you see these moms that have clean homes and their kids never have behavior issues and they make homemade meals from scratch 7 nights a week. And you don't remember that that's not real life. And you are constantly chasing this goal that's unattainable. And so you really start to lose yourself in motherhood.
What is the gender of your baby?
It's a girl!
Yay!
Happy Mother's Day, Countryside. I'm Megan, and we just wanted to take a moment to honor all the mothers out there, whether you're a mom of a baby like me or a mom of a grown baby, a grandbaby, and beyond. We just want you to know how loved and valued you are, just by God and by us.
Morning, everybody. Happy Mother's Day. What a great day it is to remember our moms. I'm Pastor John, lead pastor here at Countryside Christian Church, and I was just thinking about my mom back in the day when I was a little kid. I'll just share a brief story with you. You know, as a little kid, I thought I had it figured out quite a few times in my life, and I got pretty exacerbated with my mom, really frustrated with her, and I said, "Mom, I'm gonna run away." And my mom, she's a pretty sharp lady, and she said, "Well, you go ahead, Jonathan, you go ahead and run away. Make sure you take everything you need." Well, that kind of shocked me a little bit that she would allow me to even make a statement, let alone I could pack up and leave. So I did. I went in my room, and I put everything in my backpack that I had, everything that I thought that I needed. And yet in my mind, there was something was missing, and I couldn't put a finger on it. So I put the backpack on and came out of my room walking down the hall, and there's my mom at the front door. She's even holding the door open for me. And I'm thinking, wow, I guess this is okay. I'm going to leave. But yet there was this one more thing I needed. And when I got to the door, I looked up at my mom and I realized, and I said to my mom, "Mom, I got everything I need and I need you. One more thing. Here we go." Well, she didn't go with me. But anyway, our moms are awesome. And we just want to say we love you. Thank you so much for doing what you do. Moms actually are like the CEOs, the captain, the coach of a team, of a sports team. And they've got a lot of stuff on their shoulders. And I'm so thankful that I had the privilege of having a great mom. She's with the Lord Jesus Christ now, and she's celebrating. And I look forward to seeing her again one day. You know, we are in a sermon series called Impact, and we really haven't addressed the COVID-19 issue head on and directly. We have touched on it, but I think my process in thinking through this sermon series is that it's here, we all know about it, but what can we do? And I've been thinking that maybe some of you are thinking, where is God in this crisis that we're having? Where is God in all of this COVID-19 2020 era? And I think it's a valid question. I think it's a good question to ask, and it's something that we want to address today. Well, if you haven't yet, go get your sermon notes, or if you just want to jot it down on a napkin or an envelope, that's fine too. But in the sermon notes, you'll find places to insert the notes that I'm going to tell you about today. These are really important, because they're building blocks for having an impact, so that this momentum of Jesus in our lives not only impacts us, but we can impact other people as we go, so we could be momentum agents in our world. We can still have an impact. There can still be momentum even when we're asked to stay home. Now, I want to flesh out a question here about the first question that I asked: where is God in this whole thing? And I'd like you to answer that question. I'd like to see some of your responses. Where is God in crisis? Valid question. Just go to your keyboard or on your phone and just type in, where do you think God is? And I want to answer that. See, God wants to accomplish his mission. He still is going to accomplish his mission despite the circumstances we might be in. The circumstance we're in now with the COVID virus does not negate the fact that we still need to help people. And here's what we're about as a church. This is what our mission is. It's helping people know and follow Jesus one person at a time. As a matter of fact, would you say that with me? Helping people know and follow Jesus one person at a time. That's why we're here, Countryside. We want to continually be the message in our families, in the lives that we live. For some of us, as we go to work, if we're just at home on our computer, we want to be the message for other people. But here's the deal. We also have to understand that crisis brings an opportunity. And as a church, how are we going to respond to this crisis? Here's the deal. God didn't go anywhere. Where did God go in the middle of this crisis? He's right here. He's right here, right now. And we're going to talk about how he's going to continue having an impact in your life and in the lives of those that you come into contact with. Let's pray. Father, I want to thank you. I want to thank you for loving us, taking care of us, meeting our needs. Thank you for the wonderful weather we're having out here in the Northwest. It's such a blessing to have some sunshine, and thank you for that. Father, I want to pray for our local church right now as we are gathering together in our homes. Some of us at work on breakfast or lunch breaks, getting our phones out and just checking things out. Father, right now, I just ask that you would comfort the hearts of those who call Countryside home. And Father, we're aware of people watching us all around the world. And we also pray for them right now in the moment that they're watching this. Father, that you would comfort them as well. And that, Lord, for all of us, that you would agitate us in such a way that it would draw us to you. That there would be an impact through your Holy Spirit that would cause life change in us, and there would be a momentum that causes people to come to know you as their Lord and Savior as well. We ask these things in Jesus' name, amen. Well, if you want to live a life of impact, what do you have to do? Well, that's kind of a loaded question. We want to get right to the point today. We want to get to the point. Ready? It requires that you surround yourself with people. Now, how do we do that? Well, we are doing it right now. We have to think differently. We're surrounding ourselves with people in community via the live stream, or maybe we get on a Zoom call, but we have to stay connected in groups because a team is not just one person. Team is all of us together, functioning together. I wonder, though, if maybe right now it could be possible as a team, we need to be gearing up. We need to be reading the playbook. We need to be studying the places that each of those positions go to do their job in ministry and kingdom building. Maybe it's a time that we're studying up for that. And very soon, it's just going to explode. That our impact that we're going to have in people's lives is going to come from the time we talk about teamwork today. Quite possibly. But I think you could also apply it right now in your life. Because having an impact really is a team sport. For over 2,000 years, God has been using his team to do his work, to accomplish his mission. It's called the church. The church. Jesus picked 12 guys to start his first team. I want to read this passage of scripture to you. It's found in Mark chapter 3, verses 16 through 19. It says, Jesus went up on a mountainside and called to him those he wanted, and they came to him. He appointed 12 that they might be with him and that he might send them out to preach and to have authority to drive out demons. These are the 12 he appointed: Simon, to whom he gave the name Peter, James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John, to them he gave the name Sons of Thunder. Andrew, Philip, Bartholomew, Matthew, Thomas, James, son of Alphaeus, Thaddeus, Simon the Zealot, and Judas Iscariot, who betrayed him. This was his team. Jesus chose 12 guys. Why he chose those 12 guys? Well, I don't think we can really figure it out psychologically, because that was quite a misfit group of guys. But Jesus chose those guys to start on his team. And those 12 guys, you know, out of them, there were fishermen, there was a tax collector, there was a zealot, and yet that was his impact team. That was his impact team. And he has developed it, and that impact team is growing even today. So when you look in your notes, I want you to see who could be on your team. Who is it that could be on your impact team or our impact team as we have an impact in the lives of not only us, as God has an impact in us, but in those lives around us? First of all, you're going to see potential teammates. All followers of Jesus Christ are potential teammates. Every follower of Jesus is a potential part of your impact team. Number two, my church family. My church family could be my team. And the truth is, you're never really going to get to know the billions of Christians around the world. As a matter of fact, right now, I'd like to say hello to the people in France who are watching us. What a great way that we could connect around the globe with each other. Just a shout out to those in, I believe it's in Paris, France. But our church family are those who are Christ followers around the globe. But if you want to just bring that in a little closer, number three is the local church. And inside the local church, it is my life group. The people in your life group can have a very powerful impact as you guys work together as a team, unleashing compassion, pursuing God, and building community together. And then the final area are my godly friends. These are your closest friends, the ones that you rely on, the ones that you can confide in. And today, I want to help you understand those elements, those four areas, and I want to bring them into a personal understanding to make an impact with the team that we are on together. So number one, to make an impact with my team, this is crucial, I fully engage with my church family. This is important. The words fully engage are critical. Not half-hearted, not at an arm's length, but all in, I'm fully engaged. Church can be a lot like a football game, right? You have a group of people that are down on the field. There's 22 of them, and they're just going at it. They're working hard. They're doing all the plays, and one team's trying to score. One time, team's trying to do the defense and not let them score, and that's going on. And then if you pan up into the stadium, what do you see? You see spectators, about 92,000 spectators. And that's what the church life can be like sometimes, where there's just a group of people fully engaged, while there are spectators on the outside. And actually, I've talked to spectators because I've been one myself at sporting events. And I'll tell you what, quite often spectators want to be a part of the team. And there's a great way in how you could get on the team. And that's by asking Jesus Christ into your heart, asking him into your life, receiving him as your Lord and your Savior, and inviting him in. But to make a maximum impact for God, one of the steps is to be fully engaged. And I we could get critical about this and a little snarky on this. I'm trying not to do that because I want to encourage you. For those of you who just kind of do church when it works in your schedule and there's, you know, it falls on the every third Sunday and all the other Sundays you're doing something else, that's a problem. That's not fully engaged. A team has players who are fully engaged. That's the very first step. Part of something that's bigger than yourself. It's beyond just you taking care of you, your needs, and trying to develop something and try to grow and learn on your own. In Acts chapter 2, Peter is giving his sermon, and right after his sermon, the church starts. It's a powerful message, and someday I'd love to just go through that whole message. But for today's purpose, let's just read from Acts chapter 2. We'll start at verse 42. And this is powerful. This is the beginning of the church, and this is where we're going to build the rest of our points from. It says in verse 42 of Acts chapter 2, they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship, to the breaking of bread and to prayer. Everyone was filled with awe at the many wonders and signs performed by the apostles. All the believers were together and had everything in common. They sold property and possessions to give to anyone who had a need. Every day they continued to meet together in the temple courts. They broke bread in their homes and ate together with glad and sincere hearts, praising God and enjoying the favor of all the people. And the Lord added to their number daily those who were being saved. Now in verse 42, go and circle the word devoted. Devoted, a key word, big word, very important word. They were devoted. The church in the first century had an incredible impact because they were devoted to learning, to fellowship. They were devoted to working out and building up the community. They were devoted to one another. They were devoted to the teaching of God's word. They were committed and they were fully engaged. That's powerful. That's how the church started. Jesus chose the 12 guys to start it. Peter preaches a message, 3,000 people come to Christ that day. Boom, the church is starting to explode. But there's a process to it. There's a process to it. You have to start by being fully engaged. Because what happens as you become fully engaged, you learn something. And when you learn something, then you apply what you have learned. Because what we're seeing through this whole sermon series is that your belief leads to action. And your actions determine your impact. Will you say that with me? I know I can't hear you right now, but just say this together. We're going to start with your belief. Ready? Go. Your belief leads to action, and your action determines your impact. Romans 12:5 says, so in Christ, we, though many, form one body, and each member belongs to the others. Think about that. If you're a part of the body, maybe you're the hand of the body. If you're disconnected from the body, you don't do it any good. You don't do the hand any good. You don't do yourself any good. And you don't do the body any good if you're disconnected. Got to get fully engaged. Number two, to make an impact with my team, I commit to grow. I commit to grow with my church. One of the purposes of a church family is to help you grow in your faith, to help you become more like Jesus, to push you, to encourage you, to celebrate with you, to love you. Acts 2:46 said that every day, that's like every day. I mean, what's another word for every day? Every day, I guess is the other, yeah. Every day they continue to meet together in the temple courts. That might be a little hard for us, right? But let's get the concept of this. Every day they continue to meet together in the temple courts. They broke bread in their homes and ate together with glad and sincere hearts. I want you to pick up or pull out one word. I want you to sum up that whole section of scripture with one word. What would the one word be that would describe that? Every day they continued to meet together in the temple courts. They broke bread in their homes. They ate together with glad and sincere hearts. Type that in. What's your answer? What do you think it is? If we were to sum it all up, what's your one word answer? A huge key to having an impact in people's lives is meeting together. And we're still doing that today. We're not meeting in this building, the brick and mortar, it's closed. But the church is still open because the church is you. And so we meet together to encourage each other to do these things, right? And what are we doing when we get together? What is it? Got it? Here's the word. Worship. We get together to worship. That's a huge key to spiritual growth. And it says here, the early church worshiped together often. Every day. And they met in homes, which is going to be another teaching point in here in just a second. Now, maybe it looks different today. Maybe the transportation of the message of Jesus is being transported differently. We're using different methods, right? Used to travel in, you know, on a horse. Then it went to the Model T. Then it went to, you know, the Chevy, the 57 Chevy. And then it goes to, you know what I'm saying? Transportation changes, but the message doesn't change. Never. The message of Jesus Christ will stay the same. But here we have to understand how we are going to do it differently. And this is one of the ways we're doing it differently. Can't wait till the church reopens again and we're able to, I don't know how that looks yet, but when we get back together, that's going to be awesome. But this, the live stream, teaching and preaching to people around the world, is going to stay with us. What a great opportunity to present the gospel to Jesus Christ, gathering with everybody in Jesus' name. You know, there's really no excuse to not be meeting anywhere, particularly on a Sunday or watching it later. There's really no excuse to not be meeting in homes and smaller groups. There's no excuse. It doesn't work. There are so many avenues that we can use to get together, to worship, to pursue God, build community, and unleash compassion. And we need to continue to do that. Because here's the deal. Your belief leads to action. If you don't believe that you need to get together with people, that will lead to an action. But if you believe that gathering together, if you believe what God's word says is true, it will lead to an action point. Which takes us to the third point. To make an impact with my team, I faithfully care. I faithfully care for my church family. A big part of being on a team is caring. Caring for one another because we love one another. It doesn't just mean us always pouring out into people's lives. It also means that sometimes that might be you, where you need love to be poured back into your life. The impact that we have on a team is so vitally important. As a matter of fact, you may have heard me say this before. I didn't create it, but the word team as an acronym, I love this. I've used this in coaching and other things too. But team, if we could remember this, if we could say that the T-E-A-M means together, everyone accomplishes more. Together, everyone accomplishes more. That's phenomenal. And so let me ask you this. Are you asking, what can I do for Jesus? What can I do for Countryside? Or do you still ask, what can God do for me? What can Countryside do for me? Let's get out of the ask for ourselves and let's start thinking bigger. Acts 2:45 says, they sold their property and possessions and they gave to anyone who was in need. What a great opportunity. What a great opportunity for people to unleash compassion in their life groups. The church, well, we're here for people, but the size of Countryside, it's huge. And so there's a pretty good chance that if you're not connected, you might not get the help that you really need. So I'd encourage you to get in a life group. And my last thought for the day, number four, I make a difference with my church family. I make a difference with my church family. Acts 2:47 tells us, praising God and enjoying the favor of all the people, and the Lord added to their number daily those who were being saved. You know, we definitely are in new territory when it comes to church growth and development. And as the Lord added to their numbers daily, well, today it looks differently. And yet people are coming to Christ through the transportation of the message through live stream. They come to Christ because of the impact we're making here and now. But they're also coming to Christ because of the message that you're sharing with them. Because what you believe leads to action, and your action determines your impact. Remember from the very first sermon, Matthew 5 tells us, you are the light of the world. We collectively are the light of the world. We need to be shining bright. We need to be spreading the news of Jesus Christ by being a light. Because when light sheds itself in darkness, darkness flees. Darkness is pushed back. So let me just encourage you with this. As the light of the world, how are you intentionally making an impact in people's lives? Let's pray. Father, thank you for loving us so much that you gave us your son, Jesus, that he died for us. But Father, thank you that through that death, the shedding of his blood, we have forgiveness of sin and we have relationship restored with you. So I would ask today, Lord, help us to live in the freedom of the forgiveness that you have given us. That is so exciting that you made an impact in the entire world through your son, Jesus. And now our relationship is restored with you. Help us in turn to do the same. Help us to have an impact in the momentum that you started about 2,000 years ago. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Hey, listen, I just want to encourage you to go fill out a connection card at the end of this. Go, and if you're taking some next steps, please mark that. Let us know that you're watching with some people, and that would be great. Hey, get involved with a life group. Get involved with a life group. Get a hold of Pastor Jolene here at the church. Email the church. She'd love to get you connected in one. And invite a friend for next week. Come back next week, but bring someone with you. Invite them to watch with you. Church, I love you. God bless you. See you next week. Happy Mother's Day.